Hey, how are you? I'm Sliceville Taku, and I absolutely adore OKKO Let's Be Heroes, a series that I have only just recently caught up on. For the longest time, despite how inviting and great I found the art style as well as concept of the series to be, I just kept putting it off. And the reason for that is that at this point, I most enjoy cartoons with some sort of overarching plot or lore. And for a while, it seemed as though OKKO wasn't really doing much of that, but rather just having fun like, say, a Chowder or Amazing World of Gumball would. And don't get me wrong, those are two cartoons that I will always love and are absolutely hilarious. But at this point in my life, there's just so much media for me to consume from a multitude of mediums that sitting down and watching a bunch of inconsequential cartoon episodes just isn't really my thing. At least not at the moment. However, I did know that OKKO had some semblance of lore and plot points strung together, so it still somewhat remained on my radar. And honestly, after watching all the currently available episodes, I have to say that I really appreciate the construction of this show. The way it's able to have interesting plot points at times, whilst also not taking itself too seriously and keeping the same wacky energy throughout, is one of a kind. And maybe you're thinking to yourself that other cartoons manage to do this as well, but I say that OKKO is one of a kind in this sense because of the extent to which it is taken and just how well it is executed overall. For example, with one of its contemporaries, Steven Universe, at times, the inclusion of episodes focused on lesser character antics can sometimes offset the buildup of the more often than not, vastly more interesting gem plot points. Which leaves us with a series that more so feels split down the middle, whereas OKKO is this perfect blend of zany cartoon and overarching story. Now, one such plot point that seriously elevated my interest in this show was the introduction of Turbo KO, or TKO for short. And now, for the record, I am a total sucker for transformations. There's just something very, very satisfying about seeing characters in drastically altered states and just everything that comes along with that reality. But when it comes to transformations, the likes of anime and or video games have utilized this sort of thing far more than Western animation ever has. And so, whereas in other mediums, transformations have become a sort of commonplace trope, for cartoons, it's still a relatively new sort of thing, which allows for a whole lot of exploration, as well as potential reinvention of the concept. And with that, the psychology and takeaway you may find with TKO makes it an incredibly interesting case. Throughout the vast majority of the series, KO is characterized as this happy-go-lucky kid. He's really friendly and aspires to become a great hero because he genuinely loves helping others. But in the case of TKO, we sort of see the inverse of this. He's broody, antisocial, and has what seems to at one point be an insatiable desire for power and destruction. But I don't want to get too far ahead of myself because the buildup towards all this happens to be a gradual one. Our first glimpse of TKO comes to us from the episode Your Level 100, which revolves around KO's power level being one of triple digits, a reading widely unheard of as prior, the highest readings we had seen hadn't even reached the teens. Because of this, KO has his ego heavily inflated by the praise of all those around him, causing him to associate his self-worth with power. And with that, when faced by an overwhelming threat in front of the plaza's occupants, we for the first time see a different sort of KO. A sort of aggression he had never displayed before, which at the time, when considering how the show tends to come up with tons of silly expressions, is made easy to overlook. But the next time TKO is foreshadowed, in the episode Face Your Fears, the issue is made much more apparent and ominous. This inner darkness is said to be immensely powerful and is apparently KO's greatest fear, simultaneously making things more interesting by making it clear that this power may stem from another entity within rather than simply being an altered state. And in knowing that this is his biggest fear, we may subsequently apply that knowledge once we better know what exactly this thing is. We learn what sort of behavior and feelings KO subconsciously fears from himself. But finally, in the 25th episode titled TKO, we see this inner darkness completely manifest due to Shadowy Figure's intervention. Now, when attempting to draw out KO's anger, Shadowy Figure reminds him of how the people he cares about most tend to patronize him, which does upset him, but just isn't enough, as that doesn't seem to be the catalyst needed for his anger to materialize into power. Instead, the darkness within comes forth from KO's own self-loathing. The thought of inadequacy and/or worthlessness is enough to bring out another side of KO, which is a genuine issue KO struggles with, one that was somewhat highlighted in the episode right before TKO was initially foreshadowed. Jethro's All Yours. Jethro, being the most simple and straightforward Boxmoor robotic creation yet, is continuously unleashed upon the plaza, but unlike the usual threats, is completely ignored by Rad and Enid. Jethro is undermined by them due to how simple they perceived him to be, which is something KO is able to relate to. He sees himself in Jethro and spends the remainder of the episode trying to validate his own complexity as well as worth via Jethro's success, which to me illustrates just how shackling outwardly perception may be, even in the case of a child. When it's proven that Jethro truly isn't all that complicated within, KO immediately accepts the same of himself, abiding by the rulings and views of others and disregarding what he has bottled up within, which, as we know from the existence of TKO, is indeed pretty complicated. But yeah, when KO manages to look within, oddly enough, it's pretty dark inside, something you really wouldn't expect considering what a bundle of joy he tends to be. And here we can see it. The veering darkness within is kept caged, which may lead to some questioning. Yeah, KO is most times a super happy kid who rarely ever displays true aggression and/or rage, but is that simply because he keeps such negative parts of himself confined? Which is pretty troublesome, as it's not like such things simply go away. They fester and grow, as we're now able to see. When this darkness is released, it is KO who enters the cage. Now, I really enjoyed TKO taking over for the first time, because typically, transformations are reserved for combative situations. And I mean, sure, he does enter the fray single-handedly taking out a massive robotic threat, the likes of which Rad and Enid likely couldn't handle on their own, with a single blow, but this is done quickly as to illustrate his awesome power. From there, we have an attempt at assimilation. TKO takes on KO's typical daily life, which furthers the contrast between him and KO, allowing us to recognize TKO as an entirely different character and somewhat see him as more than just blind rage, because really, as much as he struggles, he only turns on Rad and Enid when he's referred to as cute. And admittedly, being called cute isn't inherently a bad thing. If anything, in most cases, it's a compliment, but that's the thing about communication. Our words may be interpreted a number of different ways, and in this case, TKO feels belittled and is thus enraged. Both TKO and KO don't like being looked down upon, most people don't. But in the case of TKO, he has something nobody can deny or belittle, and that's his immense power, which is why he's so quick to display it when such situations arise. And you know, as comedically edgy as TKO may be, he's not like this for no reason. In the episode KO's video channel, we get a glimpse at a TKO vlog, and once again, super edgy. But when bringing up how he's viewed by those around him, he exclaims that it's like they don't even see him, which may very well be true. Even where we currently are in the story, KO is the only one to recognize and accept TKO. Everyone he loves aims to suppress TKO, which is understandable as they love KO and is verbally denoted as such when getting him to revert back. But I hope that at some point in the future, we may tackle others accepting TKO, because it's not like he's inherently evil or anything. He's just very much misunderstood. And he's a crier. When talking about not being seen, you can see him crying, and when he's shoved back into the cage, we can once again see him crying. He's an emotional kid. But you know what? For now, self-acceptance has already resulted in some major growth. KO doesn't keep TKO in a cage anymore. And if TKO seriously wanted to, he could seize control at any moment, but he doesn't. The two have reached this sort of coexistence that's only made them stronger. Now, the last time we saw TKO was in the episode TKO's House, which, oh my gosh, was a phenomenal episode. I mean, even down to both the interior and exterior of TKO's house, you have to give the crew some respect for their attention to detail, because the place is just teeming with personality. From the overflowing stockpile of letters in the mail from KO, to the picture of their mom on the nightstand, subtly showing that despite his previous outbursts, he does love her, letting us know that he's not entirely oriented towards self-preservation alone. In this episode, we learn of TKO's animosity towards Shadowy Figure. Things get heavy when he both resents and questions his existence, feeling that despite how much nicer the environment KO's made for him is in comparison to being caged, it doesn't change the fact that he's bound to KO's existence, making it KO's world, not his. And when the two combine their efforts and manage to pin Shadowy Figure, although KO is satisfied with the surface level reasoning Shadowy Figure provides for toying with KO, TKO isn't so easily sold. He questions further, piecing together the facts to form a rather sound rebuttal. So if it wasn't already clear as to how different these two are, this episode brought it home. And although TKO didn't get all the answers he was looking for, they were able to confirm that TKO is a part of KO, not something that was created by an external source, meaning that where he resides is as much his as it is KO's. And with that, TKO is more open to socializing than ever before, and the two play video games together. Guys, the complexity of this relationship within such a goofy, fun cartoon is really refreshing. This multifaceted approach to topics like outwardly perception, inner turmoil, self-acceptance, and questioning one's existence never comes across as overbearing. And if you don't want to look at things to such a degree as I have, you're not obligated to do so, and that's really cool as it allows for people to relate to it in their own individual ways. For instance, maybe you have no inclination towards the topic of self-hatred, but the sudden entrance of TKO and gradual creep from fighting to something as simple as playing video games together may reflect the growth of a sibling relationship you find solace in. It's just like, OKKO Let's Be Heroes really has a handle on the beauty of simplicity, and I'm happy to now be a part of the ride. I'm really curious how you guys may be feeling about TKO. Have your thoughts towards him changed over the course of the show? And has this video impacted your perception of either him or KO in any way? Please let me know in the comments. And now that I'm up to date with the show, I'm hoping to make more videos on the series, so I hope you enjoyed this one. Thank you all so much for watching, and have an awesome day. I love you.